MC for the 10-hour candidate forums. So today we will be doing the campaigns, recreation, international, as well as colleges. I've received word from the postgraduate candidate Ariana that she unfortunately has lectures all day and won't be able to attend. And it looks like we've got a no-show prepared. So in order to ensure that we're able to address all the questions and leave room at the end for questions from the public, I ask that all candidates speak for a maximum of 1 minute. At the 50-second mark, the timekeeper will ding the bell once to let you know that you should be wrapping up. And from the 1 minute mark onwards, the bell will ding continuously until you finish your sentence. So we're going to be starting first with the campaigns. And so I'd like for Sean Gambit to just introduce yourself, your name, what you study, your year, and what your goals are for the year.
For this year? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, for the year that you're elected.
Yeah. So I'm Sean. I'm a third year law and politics student, and I'm running with the Real Change Team campaigns. And the three biggest things that I'd like to do is to create a coordinated effort against the 7Fs cap, to also create a 24-hour study centre, and also just to unite the students in the campaigns, really get the students involved rather than it being from the OUSA down.
So my first question to you is, what is an example of a campaign which you have run, and what's the outcome been?
One of the campaigns that I've run would have been with the Young Labour, which I've been involved in, has been, we did a lot of the organisation for, it seems like forever ago, the Cunliffe visit. When David Cunliffe came down, we ran a lot of the catering. We ran around with him and did a lot of that stuff and organised really what he did for the day in conjunction with the MPs.
So my next question to you is, what are some specific skills and qualities that you're bringing to the role to make you stand out from other candidates?
I feel like the role of campaigns is mainly an organisational one and also a political one. I feel like I'm a very organised person. I'm organised personally and with a lot of the campaign stuff I've been involved in. It's quite a lot of organisation. It's also a political one, and I think that it needs the knowledge of someone who understands the political process and how things like that can be worked with. And I feel like that that's something I'm really good.
Okay, so Sean, you ran the OUSA by-elections this year, and you were responsible for three votes. What do you think's changed since then so that people that didn't vote for you in by-elections should vote for you now?
I think, well, looking back through the campaign that I'm running now, I feel like I didn't put enough effort into the last one, and it was obviously very three votes, pretty small. But I've realised now that once you put the effort into it, you can actually get results.
So, a specific question relating to your policy about the 24-hour study space. So, how do you personally propose implementing this, given the university standards for cutting operational costs for recruitment?
See, I'm not really sure what that's going to take form as. You know, people have been asking, is it going to be the whole central library? Obviously, that's probably not realistic. Maybe a floor, the bottom floor. Something I'd really like to see is the rec centre, because I think that's something that we could really change up and make more workable for students.
And so my last question to you is, what do you think is the biggest issue that faces student activism in New Zealand?
I think it's not quite true that students are apathetic. I think that they're not really given a chance to get involved in things. We're not sure how they can really get involved in things. And I feel like the Real Change Team could really, once they're in OUSA, be involved with students. I mean, we've been on campus for the past 5 days, like, yeah, feels like 24/7 getting involved. I feel like if there's a more coordinated effort from groups like OUSA, that we can get students more involved. So I feel like it's getting students involved in the issues and making them aware of the issues. A lot of people, like when we're talking to students, I feel like aren't aware of how the 7Fs cap affects medical students that they actually have to stump up around 15 grand for their final year. So yeah, I think it's about getting students more involved.
So I've just got a fun little bonus question for you. So who would you rather be the campaign manager for and why? Jeb Bush or Donald Trump?
I feel like Donald because it would be a lot of fun. Jeb Bush because you've probably got more chance of winning. So I'll probably go for Trump because I like the fun.
Alright, so now to open the floor to allow questions from the public, I do ask that you please state your name and if you have any affiliations to candidates. So for instance, if you're running in this year's election, if you're a current executive officer, if you're otherwise associated with their campaign. So any questions from the public? Okay, I now ask that we just give a round of applause for Sean Gambit. The recreation officer candidate, so I ask that Matt Moss and all the officers. candidates start with first with Will to introduce yourself, your name, what you study, your year, and why you should be a recreation officer.
Hi everyone, I'm William, I'm a second year pharmacy student, and I want to be your recreation officer because I think that the clubs and societies on campus need more support to keep on doing what they're doing. I've been involved with clubs on campus, and I know the unique needs of clubs on campus, and I want to address those needs and make sure that they can keep on running with these performances.
Cool. My name is Matt Ross, and I'm a third year finance and accounting student. I'm the president of a 200 member club. It's over 200 members now. So I feel like I know exactly what club presidents, club members are going to want from recreation officer in 2016. So my main policy is going to be making it easier and more accessible to join clubs next year and start clubs as well. So I'll be doing things like running a featured club of the week and perhaps even a new club of the week, just to get the newer starting up clubs off the ground and on their feet. And also, you know, be increasing participation and activity within the club. So, you know, the small clubs, once they get started, they'll have something to go with, and, you know, it kind of ties into my next point, which is helping clubs gain access to OUSA resources and making sure they're aware on how to actually do that. So I'll work with the college's officer next year and as many sports clubs as I can to promote team spirit with a wider range of competitive sports, particularly between colleges, and that's what I want to do next year.
Well, so my first question is starting first with Will. Why is the formation of new clubs important, and what would you do in your capacity as recreation officer to help new clubs form? And I do ask not to cite increased funding, as that's been promised by quite a few recreation officer candidates in the past with little result.
So I think clubs are the backbone of the recreation program. So university is not just about studying, it's about having a good time, forming new bonds and meeting new people. There's quite a few ways that people can come together to form a club, and I think that there's not, aside from funding, there's other needs that they require. They need venues, they need support in terms of applying for funding. So not just getting funding, but applying for funding can be quite confusing to apply through the OUSA or for external funding. So I want to implement a sponsorship and grants manager so that they can get assistance applying for external funding, not just internal funding. I also want to provide better resources through OUSA, like increased storage space and easier access to transport for their sports and events and whatnot.
Cool. Yeah, like Will said, clubs definitely the backbone of recreation in Otago. And new clubs, you know, this is something I'm kind of passionate about because I've been a president of a club and, you know, I was there from the start, so I know what starting up a club is like. I'm lucky to have a big club now, but if I had a small club, I know how hard it would be, how confusing it would be to apply for those things, like, you know, Will said just then. And so, making it more aware of, making people more aware of how to actually get to those funds, how to write up a memorandum of understanding to apply for things from the OUSA, to be able to talk to the recreation officer as well. I feel like, you know, next year I want to open up an open door policy where anyone can talk to me, but I'll also be actively going and actually talking to the club members, talking to everyone that I can, making sure that they know who I am, and they can come and talk to me for any advice, and so that they know what OUSA can do for them.
So my next question will be beginning first with that. What do you think is the biggest limitation for the recreation officer, and how do you plan to address it?
Biggest threat limitation? Probably, I guess getting your face out there has been a limitation so far, where a lot of people don't know exactly who the recreation officer is, and I feel like that's something that I want to work on next year, so that everyone that's in a club, or at least everyone that's in the admin team for clubs, like presidents, vice presidents, even the treasurers, know who I am, and they'll know who to go to, who to send their emails to apply for funding, to apply for memorandums of understanding. And I feel like, you know, that's probably the biggest limitation I've had and, you know, heard from other club members, that they just don't know who the recreation officer is.
I think in the past, OUSA sort of struggled to promote itself to clubs and societies so they can reap the benefits. I think the recreation officers in the past being limited to not sort of driving clubs to apply for funding through OUSA or encouraging them to join the OUSA and become affiliated. I think the recreation officer should sort of aim to get more clubs involved with the OUSA and provide easier access to the resources. And I think the limitation that was in place was that the OUSA wasn't able to promote itself to clubs. And I want to introduce a newsletter to all volunteers within societies on campus so that you can hear about the benefits of the OUSA to clubs and access the benefits.
So I would now like to ask Mr. Kennedy to a specific question relating to their policies that was reported. So you also regard the funding, and so how do you propose increasing the amount of funding available to clubs with the operating budget for next year is set by this year's service level renegotiations?
When I sort of made this going on previous funding increases, it wasn't sort of to increase the amount of funds available. It was sort of to try and move clubs to using external partners for funding. So I think with a sponsorship and grants manager, recreation is a good. Clubs can easily access external funding rather than relying on OUSA funding. So if we were able to get more clubs using external grants, then there would actually be a lower reliance on OUSA funding. So potentially even 75,000, I think current years, would be plenty enough to go around the clubs if clubs were getting the support they need to apply for external funding. I don't think we need to increase internal funding. I think we need to make it easier for clubs to get out there and get external funding.
Sorry, when you're reading the questions, can you just speed up a bit?
Okay, sorry. So my question for Matt is regarding more incentives. So what are some specific examples of incentives that you would bring into action, and how do you plan on implementing them?
Okay, so I mentioned this one in my intro, which was featured club of the week. And because a big problem with club activity and participation is a lot of people join clubs. Clubs say they sign up to 50 clubs, get their lolly, and then that's it. They don't really do anything with the club after that. So having something like a feature club of the week so you can see what the club is doing, not just in clubs on clubs day, but throughout the entire year, throughout the entire semester. So, you know, maybe you're in the middle of the semester and you want to join a club, you see something in the feature club of the week, and you go to join it because you like what they're doing. And that also ties into increasing activities within the club, so the clubs are just more active in general, because I feel like that's also a big problem, that clubs just don't do enough regularly, so that people just kind of fall out of interest in that. And I feel like making funds more, you know, not increasing funds, but making them more accessible and making club admins know how to get them will increase their own events and participation and activities.
So my last question to you guys is that given the role of a recreation officer involves a lot of leadership, in working with different clubs, what is an example of some leadership skills that you have? What are the examples past?
So I'm the president of a pretty big club on campus, so I feel like that's quite a lot of leadership already. But it's also leadership in a role that, like I said before, you know, lets me know exactly what club members and admins are going to need from the recreation officer. So the leadership from this role, you know, involves running plenty of events, going to sponsors, and you know, getting funding from the OUSA itself as well. And generally, you know, posting a lot of social media, making sure everyone's able to talk to me, and able to ask me questions, able to generally know who I am. Everyone in the club knows exactly who I am, and that's what I want to bring to OUSA next year, being the face of recreation at a time.
For me, leadership is just about spearheading a strategic vision. It's about communicating and working with others. I've been involved with a national charity with over 4,000 members when I last checked. And I've run educational events for up to 130 students right on campus here. I think I've got the unique set of skills to sort of understand what clubs need and the drive to achieve what they need. And I think in terms of motivation and understanding what clubs need, that is a facet of leadership that I can bring to the recreation role.
So just a fun little bonus question. If you were to create a reality TV show centered around student life at Otago, what would it be about and what would it be?
Probably keeping up with
the I think my eyes swelled right into the back of my head, sorry. Reality TV. Gosh, I don't know. Probably something about Hyde Street or Castle Street. And generally filming the activity along there, I mean, it's... If we're making a reality TV show, we may as well make it as trashy as possible, right? So I don't know what I would call it, but something to do with those streets, filming what people do there.
Alright, so now let's open the forum to allow questions from the public.
My question is to Matt.
Okay, please cite your name and your affiliation.
Oh, sorry, I'm Jared. I'm running for vice president. And I was just wondering, you mentioned you were like the president of a large club on campus. What club is that?
It's the Esports Club.
Any other questions from the public? All right, give a round.
student. What was the last part of the question? So I'm studying for colleges, obviously. What I want to bring to the role since I'm this president student network to advance our issues. I also want to do things like make sure activity funds are spent on students. And it's kind of just making sure colleges are involved in OUSA things right from the get-go.
Okay, so this is just a bit of clarification. You mentioned that you want activity fees to
be
involved activities.
Okay, so every student when you sign up to report is roughly around $800, and this is included in their fees. That is set aside for activities. Yet when you want to go on a ski trip or you want to do an extracurricular event, you often have to pay. So I just kind of, I'm not accusing anyone of, you know, some corrupt scandal or something, but we just kind of want to figure out why are we paying for a ski trip when we're paying $800 in fees.
Yeah. So my first question to you is, what do you think is the biggest issue that which faces students more?
See, Otago has 14, 13 halls, huge amount of halls, so they're very different. As a college's office for OUSA, I think they need to just know who we are. Some of the issues they face would be things like maybe they've got a small paper, so they can't offer a tutor. So why doesn't OUSA hook them up with things like the past courses, things like that? Making sure that they know that maybe where the halls miss the welfare and education issues, we're there as a safety net to help them.
My next question to you is, how do you propose increasing OUSA's visibility in halls, given that halls can control and limit access from outsiders, including OUSA?
So there is that, but I don't think it's reasonable to say that they're not OUSA kind of thing. I do think that we can get into the halls, we can throw events targeted at first years, we can be involved. It's not a matter of if, it's how. You know, using the present student network to advance issues. So Sean, who's running the campaign, said we want to do a campaign to try to lift the 70 FTS cap. My job will be to cater that to the first years, pretty much, first years and halls. So it's just making sure they know what we're doing. It's quite simple.
My next question to you, Bayden, is how do you plan on addressing the antagonistic relationship between different halls? So for instance, everybody else in Raleigh.
You can throw it into all events, you can come together, but a lot of it is actually what we're like basically makes it harder. We've got hall rivalries and stuff. Some of that's good, some of that's bad. It's whether it has to be addressed or not is another question. But you know, like we all know that Sal and Knox have a huge rivalry. Is that a bad thing? I don't know. There's good things come out of competition, bad things, so maybe just put a regulation where it needs to be.
So my next question to you is, how do you plan on addressing the high rate of dropout amongst first-year students in comparison to the rest of the student body?
So I'm assuming it's a lot around the health stuff this year program. Look, I actually came to university as a health sci student, decided to be a law student a week before. The only difference between me and them is they did the first semester. A lot of that is going to be before. You don't sign up to go to university, you sign up to do law at university, theatre at university, something else at university. So it's something that the college's officer would find a huge challenge. Like that's a big macro issue. That's going to have to be something you're going to be involved in. No, it's not going to be your responsibility to fix that. You're going to have to be involved.
So my last question is just a fun one. So if you could speak with any deceased person, who would it be and why?
To just choose one. A deceased person.
Anyone in history?
Yeah, I don't know. Look, there's Nelson Mandela. I know that's really boring. Michael Jackson's always the classic one. I know. There'd be too many. I want to talk to people now. I want to talk to Luke Clinton. That's who I want to talk to, but yeah.
Any questions from the floor?
International Clubs. I'm currently writing a student blog for the International Office as well. Why did I pick Otago was actually a funny story because I only found out I was going to Otago 2 weeks before I came. So my dad was a university student at Canterbury, and pretty much he looked at Wikipedia and thought Dunedin was a really quiet town with 20,000 people. Obviously he did not realise all week it's quite busy. But should I talk about policies? So firstly, policies for international would be more accessibility, like how are you supposed to know what international students want if you don't get up there and talk to them? And definitely more international events catered for international students, because I feel like the focus is more on international clubs at the moment. So it would be good to kind of have a balance between international clubs and students. And also, I think lastly, it would be more representation for our rights and needs. Yeah, that's all.
So my first question to you is, what relevant skills and experience will you bring to the role?
I think I just answered it. I've been here for 5 years. I've known the whole foundation till PhD route. I know what's expected for each path, which I feel like it's interesting for international service officer who normally just come in straight for uni and then leaves after undergraduate. So I think that's that. And also with the International Cultural Council, with my work, I've been Singapore Club President in 2012. I've been ICC Vice and President in 2013 and 2014. So I think I know the club aspect of it. So I think I bring both skills as an international student essay and also as an international club experience. Yeah.
So given that the ISO in the past few years has had a significant amount of conflict of interest with members of the International Cultural Council and the former ICC president, how do you plan on addressing this conflict of interest?
I never felt like there was a conflict of interest because I'm not sure about this year because it has never been brought up until this year, and I'm not really sure about the mechanics of it. But I feel like looking at it, Camille, who was the ISO, which I worked with constantly, always had a dichotomy where ICC was only with the events, and those events that were planned were always consistent with the ISO's vision. So whatever new events he wanted us to plan, like, he would just tell us. And I have no idea behind the admin side of things, so there was always that disparity. So I don't feel like there was a conflict of interest as ICC president. Yeah.
So how do you plan on increasing engagement from smaller international clubs?
I think increasing engagement from smaller international clubs is one of the big issues that even as ICC that I faced, especially as OSC. Singapore Club was a club for 18 members only. But I think one of the biggest issues would be for more of a cultural festival. I think one of the ISO's, the International Cultural Night is a good event to plan, but I feel like we should take it up a notch by having an international cultural festival where we can actually promote more of the different cultural elements of the smaller cultural clubs and probably more exposure, such as maybe put it in the Octagon or in Union Hall, where a lot of people will be able to know more about the smaller international clubs. Yeah.
So my last question to you is, what do you think is the biggest issue facing international students at Otago?
I think the biggest issue would be when you first come to Otago. Like, when I was a student, like, when I first came, I didn't have any friends. Like, I was just one Asian form, not knowing what to do. So I feel like the biggest issue would be the welcoming aspect, making international students feel welcomed into this Otago, into, like, the whole lifestyle, the party culture and stuff, because normal international students aren't that big on this culture. So I think the biggest issue is also bridging the gap between the international students and the local students and making them feel comfortable when they first get in.
Alright, so my last question to you is just a fun one. If you were to be stranded on a desert island and go for a rescue, who would you bring with you and why?
I think I would bring my dad, because my dad has always been resourceful and he's always been the voice of reason and advice. And I mean, it would be fun that, like, I'm daddy's girl, sorry, so he'll pretty much do everything for me while I just lie there in the sun. I know I sound like a spoiled brat, but yeah.
Alright, now I'd like to open the forum to allow questions from the public. Please have a round of applause for Rachel.